Mabern, born March 20th on this day 84 years ago. We're standing in front of the legendary Birdland Jazz Club, which is no longer there. It closed down many years ago. But I'm here because this is one of Harold's favorite places in the world. He came here from Chicago in 1959. And the first thing he did, he had $2,500 in this sock, $2,500 in this sock. And he likes to say that was before plastic baggies even. And he came right to Birdland, and standing outside was a great cannonball, Adelaide. And he said, "Hey, Big Hands, you want a gig?" And Harold's like, "Yeah." So he went down there and sat in with the great Harry Sweets Edison. And Sweets said, "All right, man, play Habit, 8-bar intro." And Harold said, "What the heck's Habit?" But he fumbled through his 8-bar intro, found the key, and then realized through the second chorus that he's playing "You're Getting to Be a Habit with Me." First chorus, he didn't know what he was doing. Second chorus, he got it. And from there on, the legend of Harold Mabern grew in New York City. Also, he loved being here because all the movie stars were here. Ava Gardner, Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, all the greats. Miles Davis, John Coltrane, Cannonball Alley, Lee Morgan. And one of the most special nights was Monday Night Jam Session Night. And that was one of the greatest gigs they have in the world. And Harold played down here many times. But his favorite group to see here was the great Count Basie and the great Sonny Payne. I can only imagine the great times they had there. So in honor of Sonny Payne and Count Basie, I'm going to flip on stick. Happy birthday, Harold Mabern. Standing outside Slugs, New York City, 3rd Street, between B and C, 242. Harold Mabern played here many, many times with the great Lee Morgan, Wayne Shorter, Roy Haynes. I've been around this area for 20 years. I never stopped here. But I wanted to come here today on his birthday. On February 19th, 1972, the great Lee Morgan was shot here. And Harold Mabern was there. It changed his life. But I know it meant to. I mean, Lee Morgan was his main man. He was a brother to him. So I just wanted to come down here and pay a little respect to Harold and Lee Morgan. And this was the Jazz Club Slugs, 242 East 3rd Street. A rhythm that Harold played on the piano that he learned from the great Phineas Newborn, and they would play it as they were comping or soloing, and I just picked it up and used it as part of my drum solo. And so it's just really triplets. I saw Harold Mabern at the Village Vanguard. He was playing "What a Difference a Day Made" with the great George Coleman, and his comping was da 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 da. And so he would do it, and then Billy Higgins would follow him. So it'd be da 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 da. Ladies and gentlemen, a truly special treat. I'm joined by the great Vince Herring, and we're going to play one of Harold's most popular tunes called "The Beehive," named after a club in Chicago. Thank you.
glad I had a chance to meet Harold Mabern and get a chance to play music with him, but just be around him. That's one of the great things about being in New York. I had a chance to meet many, many special people and to appreciate who they are besides musically who they are. And Harold was a great man. And if you had a chance to meet him, you don't need me to tell you that. But he was a very special human being, and he just happened to play piano. And it would be his birthday. Happy birthday, Harold, from Vincent Herring and the Smoke family and Joe Farnsworth and everybody else in ear's reach.
What a great surprise that was, playing the Beehive with the great Vince Herring. A Harold Mabern tune that he said he would like to have given that tune to Miles Davis, because he basically wrote it with Philly Joe Jones in mind, but a jazz club in Chicago. He loved talking about sitting in the front row and Clifford Brown's bell was right in front of his face. And Max was playing so fast and loud, first tune, that Clifford had to switch the armature in the middle of the solo because his lips were burning. And Max talked about practicing all day long with Miles just to get ready for that first number with Charlie Parker, because they're going to come out fast too. So those guys sure set the standard, man. I met Harold in 1986, and then a year later, Eric Alexander came to William Patterson College. He loved William Patterson College. He loved teaching there. I think he loved William Patterson more than William Patterson loved himself. Fittingly that he died his last day on Earth, he was teaching there.
Well, tomorrow would have been Harold Mabern's 84th birthday. We sure do miss him. He taught me everything. He taught me how to think about music in the way that I think about it now. He changed the direction of my entire life. He taught me how to be a better human being. He taught me to use my brain and to have a real book and a music library in my mind instead of on a music stand in front of me. And I can never repay him as long as I live for all the things he did. I can just attempt to share some of that wisdom with others and let them know how truly grateful I am to have known that man. He was the most decent human being I've ever met. This is a tune he showed me. I'll play 2A sections. He showed it to me when I was 19 years old. I had to learn it by ear. It was hard. I've never performed it live. I still remember it. Why? Because he was a great teacher. It's called If This Isn't Love, appropriately enough.
Listening pleasures this week, I would highly recommend Harold's records, Rake It and Scrape It, A Few Miles from Memphis, Greasy Kid Stuff, one of Christy's favorite records, another get-together by the Jazz Tet, Jackie McLean's Consequence, Hank Mobley, Dippin', Lee Morgan, The Gigolo, Betty Carter's favorite record, Inside Betty Carter, with Roy McCurdy and Bob Cranshaw. You like that one?
Yeah.
And
Grant Green's very first record with Elvin Jones, All the Gin's Gone. And of course, all the records with the great Eric Alexander, and one of my favorites, George Coleman, Manhattan Panorama.
It's been a great time going to Birdland and thinking about Harold in the 50s, Slugs, thinking about all the gigs we did together, Smoke, Loggies, Smalls, Mesro, Fat Cat, Village Vanguard, Dizzy's, Blue Note, $10 gigs, $2,000 gigs, Steinway Pianos, Rhodes, Fender Rhodes. Didn't matter, he played the same no matter where it was. He was a house pleaser, man. He played for the people. And at the end of the set, he'd play a tune for the cast just to make sure the cast knew what was up, which is always pretty great. He always played for the people. And I always gave him a ride to the subway or the hotel he stayed in. He liked to treat himself. Or back home. The one thing we always did was stop off and get a hot dog. He loved braised papayas, mustard, and onions. So on his birthday, I'm going to have a little treat myself to a little hot dog. And he loved telling the story once. He had some money left over, and he treated, get this, Bobby Timmons, Doug Watkins, and Paul Chambers. They walked from Midtown down to Lower East Side, and he bought them each two hot dogs each and a Coca-Cola. He just loved being around the cast, man. I loved him. So happy birthday, Harold. This one's for you. Later.